Justin Trudeau joins me live in Studio Q. Hello, sir.
Hello, John.
Nice to see you.
Good to be back.
And congratulations on the birth of your book.
Thank you. As you know, it's quite the process, but it was really, really exciting almost to be able to dig into how I've been shaped as an individual and hopefully as a leader.
I assume you learned about yourself in the process?
One can't help but learning about oneself. The challenges that you go through looking at them once again with a fresh eye to sharing them really sees, okay, this really did impact on, you know, whether it was my parents' divorce or whether it was the constant fight to get out from under the shadow of my father. You end up looking back and saying, oh, well, I sort of handled that fairly well, or look what I became, or look what I learned of it, in a way that self-examination is helpful. But you know, this isn't a personal catharsis. This is very much about me sharing a vision for this country that was shaped by my experiences.
Yes, it is a very readable book, and there's some very poignant moments. The one when you talk about the loss of your dad, it really rung raw and true for me, and I appreciated that segment. I thought today we would have, you heard me kicking off this series, a practical, if not a philosophical conversation. I mean, this book isn't just, as you say, the book title, Common Ground. It's a mission statement, and you write about how your party wants to unite Canadians rather than exploit our differences. So to begin with, simply put, how does arts and culture fit into that vision? What role should it play?
Well, first of all, I mean, I'll admit to my bias right now. I'm a Quebecer, so I think arts and culture is hugely important beyond just the economic sphere. Obviously, we're talking about around $85 billion contribution to Canada's GDP from the arts and sector area across the country, and that makes it sound economic sense, particularly when we look at how Canada is projecting its identity and its influence around the world through market access, but also through the stories we tell. But arts and culture is also about challenging ourselves and defining ourselves at the same way. Challenging ourselves because artists are always the ones that look at reality with a different perspective and challenge us to step outside of our comfortable spaces and really ask tough questions about who we are as a society and where we're going. But celebrate and define ourselves as well, because there's always been this angst about what is the Canadian identity. I think you and I have had conversations about this before, where there is no typical cultural or religious or even linguistic or ethnic or geographic definition of what a Canadian is, because we come from so many different parts of the world with so many different stories. The actual definition of what a Canadian is around shared values and shared experiences, whether it's winter or whether it's values of openness, respect, compassion, and so on. This particular lens of how to build a country around larger things than, you know, national identity is something that is incredibly relevant around the world.
Shoveling snow certainly unites us on some level.
Pushing an old lady's Buick out of a snowbank, yeah.
When you, I'll get to some of what you've just said and how it might relate to policy, but just on a personal level, when you say as a Quebecer, because we often think about culture in sort of the collective Canadian identity, but for you personally, how would you say arts or culture has shaped who you are?
My father, growing up, made a point of exposing us to the ballet, to great symphonies and musicians who'd actually often come by the house and, you know, play on the piano and share with us. I think there was always an attempt by my father to share with us high culture. At the same time as my brothers and I, when we were with our mother, were very much consumers of popular culture. And that blend, I think, really caused me to reflect very much on what culture is. And I say as a Quebecer, because obviously in Quebec, there is a robust star system with its own gossip magazines and its own consumption of local culture that is a few steps ahead or beyond where the rest of Canada is in terms of celebrating our local icons. So Quebec's always done well with that. But the question that is always interesting to me is why? You know, what is it about Quebec that has had it? And I think a big piece of it is what makes Canadian culture so relevant in the world in general, which is Quebecers have always struggled against the fact that they're a minority, a linguistic and cultural minority within a much larger English North America. And that has caused Quebecers to respond very strongly to their own stories, artistically, politically, intellectually, but very much how we celebrate our identity is a big part of being positive about promotion of Quebecer and Quebec culture, and not just the defensive, okay, let's keep others out. How that scales up now, one of the reasons people like Xavier Dolan and others are doing so well, or Denis Arcand in years past do so well on the world stage, is this is a challenge that people are facing around the world. Given the globalization of culture, how do you celebrate your own minority? How do you define yourself and tell your stories in a way that is resonating with other people from other parts of the world? And it's not sufficient to try and pretend that downtown Toronto is New York in order to sell your story. Can we sell it as Toronto? And I think that's something that is coming around. Quebec has a bit of a lead on, but Canadian culture is growing in that.
When you talk about you and your dad, there's a couple of funny moments in the book. I mean, first of all, you talk about your love of Archie, and then some real high culture there. But then you go on to, I mean, you graduate from that into J.R.R. Tolkien and Asimov and Stephen King. And you say that your dad quite pointedly thought of that stuff as, I think he called it, crap was the word, exactly. Tell me about that disconnect between you and your dad.
Well, it was something where my father really believed in facts and in philosophical treatises and a real sort of intellectual approach to fiction and philosophy in general, whereas I was always fascinated by narrative, by story, by storytelling, to watch a protagonist evolve through various challenges. And I remember huge arguments with my brother Alexandre, who's become a documentary filmmaker, who always would say, give me encyclopedias and dictionaries for Christmas, don't give me fiction books. And I said, no, I'll take the fiction books. Where, you know, I'd say, look, in a well-written and well-researched novel, you can, you know, discover huge amounts about the past or someone's particular life through the lens of a thoughtful person, the author, who's choosing to share it. And you get much more insights into people's motivations and flow than you can out of reading an encyclopedia.
So how do you, when you out yourself as being a pop culture junkie of sorts as a kid and growing up into that, how do you feel about that then being used as another example by your detractors of the superficiality of Justin Trudeau? The National Post referred to your love of popular literature over the classics as evidence that you may have an undisciplined mind compared to your competitors, Prime Minister Harper and Mr. Mulcair.
I don't know. I wonder if Prime Minister Harper tells a story of Polyphemus in the cave to his children, as I have told to my kids. There is room for both the canon of classical literature, from the Iliad and the Odyssey to the Les Misérables to everything else, and an appreciation of more popular culture. I'm still arguing with my wife about when the right age to show Star Wars to Xavier is, but that's a balance that I think people are very comfortable with. But to your question on how I deal with the attacks, for me, I take a step back from it, and I choose to highlight how that's two very different approaches to politics, where one approach is it's a game, and the point of the game is to score as often as you can against your opponent and knock them down and knock them off track and attack and you'll get advantage through through that approach. Whereas my approach is much more about, okay, these are our common challenges. This is where we disagree. Can we, you know, debate about how we disagree and try and figure out a way to serve people? Can we focus on bringing people together rather than highlighting the contrasts and the differences? And for me, as I've said a number of times, I'm going to let my opponents try and focus on me. I'm going to stay focused on the people I'm hoping to serve.
By the way, Prime Minister Harper knows some Beatles songs, from what I recall, as well. So he's not a stranger to pop culture either. It's clear.
Justin, no, I was suggesting that he was perhaps a stranger to ancient Greece.
Yes, you were. No, I was referring to the criticisms that you've received about this being evidence of the undisciplined mind. The other candidates, I don't think, or the other folks are not immune to a popular culture, nor should they be, which I do believe is culture. The question of where the political parties are at these days on culture and the arts becomes quite amorphous, as you know, because it's not always at the forefront of policy discussions. It's not leading headlines. And we know your stand, for example, on marijuana policy, on abortion, on government transparency. As you balance these priorities, how committed are you to building a nation where cultural industries like music, film, and publishing can flourish? And how do we get there?
Okay. The single focus that I have on governing this country, or moving towards governing this country, is to create a country in which the largest number of people have the best possible jobs. That's a successful economy in the 21st century. And one of the things we're seeing with the stalling of the middle class is there's a real concern that the success that our parents built for us is going to be harder and harder to pass along to our kids, that maybe we've reached some sort of peak where the next generation won't have the capacity to succeed. So, given the fact that a lot of manufacturing jobs of the past have been offshored, we have to look at where are Canada's strengths. There will always be natural resources, and those will always be an element of it. But we know now that how we develop those natural resources depends very much on the kind of science and knowledge economy we layer onto them, and the kind of responsibility we build around how we extract and develop our natural resources. But on the other side of things, what is Canada's comparative advantage in the world? And one of the great advantages we have is that in the ideal, Canada is seen as a place where things are done right, things are done in a good way. There's a quality inherent in a Canadian brand that if someone sees a Canadian product on a shelf beside some other product, hopefully, and we certainly like to think so, they'll be inclined to say, okay, if I buy the Canadian product, I know I'll have a good quality, it'll be well done, everything like that. We have to make sure that we're safeguarding that brand. Mm. And a big piece of that brand is the fact that we're this one country that has figured out how to make diversity a source of strength and not a source of weakness. And the fact that we are a country that has come together with stories from every corner of this world means that we have a story to tell to the world that is more important than just about any other, which is on a globalized planet, how do we succeed when the traditional definition of a state, of a country, no longer holds?
But some would say the institutions or the ability to tell those stories is under attack or being cut back.
Absolutely, and that's exactly where I'm going. So our capacity to share, to tell that story, and to share with the world our success comes down not to, you know, trade missions to sell Canadian products or participation in you know, humanitarian or even military missions to promote Canadian values. Although those are all three very important things. It's also on how we share the Canadian dreams and the Canadian successes. And that means how we share more soft diplomacy. Those are great artists, our great composers, our great musicians, our great directors and film producers. How we share those stories is an intrinsic part of not just how Canada succeeds economically, but how we can influence the world to do a better job of embracing different stories and different different cultures. And that's something that is at the heart of a Canadian government's responsibility to make sure we're doing.
Well, yeah, you lost me a little bit because I was asking about institutions. I'll give you an example. I mean, right now, a number of heritage institutions face deep funding cuts. Libraries and archives, in particular, grappling with a reduced workforce, fewer resources. They already said they were strapped. If your party, for example, returns to power, would you restore funding to libraries and archives?
My party has always stood for the fact that science is important, that history is important, that sharing knowledge, that there's no question that as we move toward through the 21st century, things are going to become more digitized, and a traditional archives or a traditional library will look somewhat differently. But the way to do it is not to toss them all into a bin the way we saw on the East Coast last year. You need to have an actual plan for the digitization and the support and the training of the next generation of librarians and archivists who can access this information and evaluate it. That is a huge priority. So yes, we need to preserve our history, our culture, our knowledge, and render it accessible in the 21st century.
Does that mean restoring the funding?
That means restoring the funding, but looking at it not with, oh, we need to recreate these institutions of the 19th and 20th centuries. It's what does a 21st century museum or archive look like, and how do we invest in that?
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, you were a teacher a long time ago. You're getting old, of course, but do you have a vision or an idea of what, just out of curiosity, is a sidebar of what a library of the future should look like?
Well, one of the things I did as a teacher, and this was in the early, I was the first, the last generation of teachers to operate in a pre-Google era, and it became rapidly obvious even then. Actually, I was trained in the pre-Google era. I started teaching in a post-Google era. Or in the Google era, we realized rapidly, the ones who were thinking about critical thinking and how we empower our students, that it's not about teaching memorization anymore. It's not about knowing what year the War of 1812 was in or what have you, to take the old joke about Napoleon's white horse. That what is more important is the connection and the flow of history, understanding how one event falls into another, understanding the context that you're in. And in concrete terms, learning how to do a good search or evaluate different web pages. I had an exercise with my students where we laid out, I said, all of you go and find the poem called Desiderata. You go placidly amid the noise and haste and remember what peace there may be in science, silence, and so forth. And find it on each different page. Everyone has to find a different page with that on. And it's the kind of thing that people throw up on their web pages as a little bit of doggerel that they like. In a class of 15 kids, every single one had a different origin for it, a different place for it. Every single version was different. So then I pulled out an actual hardcover book and I said, okay, I have it in here. Which one is the right version? And they defaulted to, well, the one that's in your book is right. I'm like, actually, no, this one's wrong. And that one's wrong and this one's wrong. And we came together to evaluate the merits of it. We're going to need a lot more of that, a lot more of questioning, you know, to be typical about it, is it history or her story? Is it, you know, whose story are we telling? Why are we telling it? There has to be a lot more room for critical thought and critical examination if we want to have powerful citizens in the coming years.
Well, and Libraries and Archives Canada, I might mention, is the institution that literally houses the nation's history, including documents that have been used in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, right? So speaking of heritage institutions, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you about the CBC. Yes, you know this is coming. You've said, and I can quote you, that Canada's public broadcaster needs strong, secure, stable funding. So everybody looked at that and kind of went, well, that's what everyone says, no matter what they end up doing. What does that look like to you? Strong, secure, stable funding?
For me, particularly now in the 21st century, we have to go back to the mandate. We have to go back what CBC exists for, Radio-Canada as well. It's about binding together a very, very big, empty, in many parts of it, nation with very different stories to tell in a sense of collective shared values in both official languages. That's what it's all about. And for that, a country like Canada, and conservatives across the board have always argued against the need for a properly funded public broadcaster. I believe in a country like Canada, or you know, any country for that matter, but particularly here, we need to have a robust place for news, for cultural celebration, for exchanging the stories that bind us together from St. John's to Victoria, to from Alert to Baffin Island to Nunavut, Tuktoyaktuk. The challenges that we have is going to be, what does that look like in the 21st century? In the multi-channel universe, in the fact that you're not just getting three channels over the air, that you have YouTube, that we have Netflix, that we have all these range of sources and voices, how do we make sure that there is a place where we can tie together all of our stories and use that as a launching pad for so many other stories that, again, that diffuse elsewhere?
But what does the funding model look like? I mean, when you say conservative, have always argued against public broadcasting. Certainly some do, but some don't. I mean, when former Heritage Minister James Moore was here, he said, oh, I support public broadcasting, but these cuts are necessary and the CBC is going to have to adjust to make it work. You'll of course find a lot of people, especially in this building but beyond, who say the CBC can't fulfill its mandate if it's one of the worst funded broadcasters, public broadcasters in the world, which it is.
You'll forgive me for not fully believing James Moore when he talks like that, because the Conservative Party has regularly made money off of attack ads and sent out donations based around attacks against the CBC. And that approach, you can't convince me that there is a deep and strong support and value.
But you also know the cutbacks began under the Liberal Party in the 1990s.
Yeah. And
so what would you do differently?
I'd make sure that CBC has the funding necessary to run as a 21st century operation. Now, we don't know what that looks like yet, and that's a really important part of the discussion. What if we were to invent the CBC wholeheartedly for the 21st century, for a wireless world, for a digital world, what would it look like? I think that's a conversation that we haven't had in a long time, partially because the CBC's been in survival mode. Yes, the Liberal Party had to make really tough decisions through the 90s, but got us into a position where then we can turn around and spend and create surpluses that were going towards arts and culture. So it was a necessary step in reestablishing fiscal health for this country that allows things to unfold. Where do we continue to fund and how do we continue to fund it? All I know is the funding needs to be substantial and significant, because CBC...
Meaning increased or...
Increased.
Sure. All right, that's what I wanted to know. Yeah.
Sure. But, I mean, how much and right. Exactly how depends a lot on how we create a vision that is relevant for the 21st century.
The idea of ask you about CanCon. The idea of mandating, regulating Canadian content really came to bloom in the 70s, particularly under your father's administration. This is the era of Netflix. You keep referring to how things are changing culturally. They are. There's now a universe of viewing and listening choices. In your view, is Canadian content still something the government can regulate and control, and should it?
I think the way to promote Canadian content is to make sure that our world-class artists, directors, writers, actors are able to actually function and succeed in Canada. CanCon, I typically use the radio model from the 60s and 70s and into the 80s and 90s even, where the mandated requirements around playing Canadian artists gave rise to world-class Canadian artists who are successful all around the world. Now, people would love to be able to turn around and say that needs to happen in TV and radio, and there were attempts at TV and film, and there were attempts to make that done, but it never quite landed. And now, in the YouTube universe, you simply can't make that happen. So where we have to go is say, okay, how can we make sure that our cultural industries, because they are industries, that our creatives are able to make a living telling and sharing those stories in a way that is received but not just by Canadians, but by the world. And that goes back to what I was saying earlier, the fact that the way Canadians are telling their stories are resonating in places around the world that we should be much stronger about reaching out to. I think the secret around our success is in the quality of what we have to say and how we have to say it. But if we're going to compete on the world stage with the Hollywoods of the world, we're going to need to have a government and public partners in society that are going to say, this matters to us.
The way you started that answer was interesting. You're talking about we have to get the funding, the support to the writers, to the artists, to the dancer, to the root of the creators. How do you do that? I mean, that in some ways, that's been one of the knocks against CanCon, certainly in the music realm, for example, that while it served its function, some will argue now, I don't necessarily agree with this, but some will argue, you can fulfill your CanCon mandate by playing Celine Dion and Bryan Adams, and that's not necessarily supporting all the independent artists out there who really need the support to foster and find fertile ground to continue building our Canadian story. How do you get to them?
Well, I think that's one of the things that is really interesting when you scrape the sort of the debates around copyright and models is that there was an entire industry built up around managing artists and around producing artists, about moving from the creative, connecting the creative to the consumer. And what we have now with the advent not just of the internet as a means of communication, but the democratization of high-quality film video cameras and access to markets and consumers directly around the world through the internet means that business model that included big record companies typically in the middle or film distributors is no longer the only way to get things out there. So how we actually, maybe by giving fairer tax credits that allow for artists to go through the good years and the bad years that come with an artist's life as they sell 1 year and then spend another year or two creating and then sell that next year. As we look at how we're encouraging the kind of grants that have always been accessed by the big networks to produce local shows and make those more broadly accessible so you don't have to necessarily go through networks. There's a lot of different ways of doing it, but I think understanding that the middleman that we used to be so enthusiastic about funding is no longer the person we need to fund.
It used to be the old joke about or it's kind of a heartbreaking comment that people would make and say, well, it looks Canadian, i.e. the quality of it is somehow less impressive than something you would see that would be created south of the border or from Europe. Do you think that that's been a problem for Canadian culture?
I don't know that it's, I mean, obviously our the quality of our filmmaking and our technical capacities are every bit as good. I mean, maybe not quite as many explosions as a Michael Bay film, but that half the CGI seems to be made in the outskirts of Montreal and Toronto these days is really an indicator that we can play on that stage. I think one of the challenges that we've had is a typically Canadian problem that I know you've encountered a whole bunch of times, which is we don't generally think someone is great unless they've made it big elsewhere, unless they've hit it big in the States, the great and glorious exception, of course, being the hip. But other than that, I mean, we tend to wait till someone is approved of on the world stage before we flock to valuing them. And I think that's a challenge that Canadians have that, amongst Canadians, Quebecers have managed to eschew a little bit.
What is it about, how has it been, bringing it back to Quebec? Because Quebec is often used on this show, amongst other places, as an example of where it's done right, whether it be a show like Tout le monde en parle getting higher ratings than anything else in Canada, and those are basically just centered in Quebec, or a film by Xavier Dolan, there seems to be the notion that something has been done right there to build the star system, to build a cultural legacy, to build a strength and supportive creative community. Is that about government support and funding?
No, it's not about any of that. It's about the consumers. It's about individuals wanting to hear their own stories. It's about people being confident enough to say, you know what, I do want to watch this made in Quebec movie rather than going to down the street to the Hollywood blockbuster. And that's a leap that government and our society should be encouraging in terms of a strength and a pride in Canada, a reflection of how great we are and how world-class we are. And that hasn't always been portrayed in as effective as fashion. I mean, so many of the CanCon style ads end up being overly earnest and hokey almost sometimes. We have to get away from that a little bit because we're a mature people. And I see it a lot in Canadian literature. The fact that, you know, CanLit is now world class. There is a maturing there of not just the creators, but of the Canadian consumers.
But how
consumers.
Do you build that confidence in this country? By the way, and this is exactly what the current government of Canada and the Conservative Party says they have done. They brought back the confidence to Canada. When you intimate that what exists in Quebec, the desire to see each other's stories because of that confidence, that doesn't necessarily exist in the rest of Canada. How do you build that?
Well, first of all, I would take issue with you suggesting that, and I'm not going to spend my time slagging my opponents, but the Conservatives have very much tried to do that around military history, around a sort of glorifying patriotism.
Olympic victories,
the Own the Podium was started by Liberals, and that was something that we understood, and it's great to be celebrating it, absolutely. But that hasn't yet translated into the kind of revitalization of Canada's vision of self-worth. I mean, too many people are looking at the black eye we have on the world stage on an environmental level, at the megaphone our prime minister uses on the world stage for international relations, that as not being something that we can stand as proudly on as we'd like to.
So the question of how we build that confidence? To turn proactive, what would you do?
First of all, I start sharing our if Canadians are going to want to see our artists and our productions succeed on the world stage, well, I'll make sure that the government is supporting programs like Route Commerciale and Promare to be able to have our movies, our touring troupes go overseas and demonstrate their level of success.
I'll come back to your book, Common Ground. Throughout the book, you weave in stories of your father and how you are following in his footsteps and how you're not in some cases. He was, our former Prime Minister, Pierre Elliott Trudeau, felt strongly about Canadian content. He was known for really having championed Canada's cultural industries, finding a home for the National Gallery of Canada, for example. Mm-hmm. Has your father's legacy informed your approach to cultural policy, do you think?
Yes. His love of arts and culture and his desire to make sure that we were celebrating that, whether it was through the National Gallery or the Museum of Civilization or supporting Canadian artists, both on a personal level and around the world. This is something that I think Canadians miss, having a strong and visible presence in the world's imagination. We've gone through good moments of it. I think we can get that back.
And speaking of the world's imagination then, having grown up as a Trudeau, you've had the privilege of traveling around the world, you've met with foreign dignitaries, you've been exposed to a lot of other cultures. So drawing on that experience, what would you say? I mean, this is, again, how we try and define what you might argue is the undefinable, but what unique quality does the Canadian cultural industry have to offer when it comes to sharing our artistic talent with the world?
Our capacity to draw on every corner of the world and to blend Bollywood with Ukrainian dance, to draw on the traditions of great musical stories from around the world into a modern, harmonious entity that resembles the city of Toronto in its diversity. I mean, we have a capacity to share stories in a way that is universal. This idea of success, of working hard, of building a success for yourself, for your community, but that draws its cultural links to every corner of the world without being a mirror or a bad imitation of the country of origin's art, but an evolution of it. And that's it's a challenge sometimes, because as we know, so many of our immigrant communities are a more conservative version or more protective of the home culture than even is going on back home, where there's a natural evolution. I mean, you get it in French, where we use words like fin de semaine instead of weekend, which they now use in France, but we want to protect the French words and not just take English words. Well, there is something that Canada has to share with the stories of the world that comes down to celebrating diversity and not trying to minimize it or get past it, that I think Canada is extraordinarily relevant in a way that the melting pot of the United States just doesn't do. Everyone gets plastered with the same American brush there all too often, and yet Canada is able to add cultural reflections and expressions is a multi-layered story.
What are you thinking of when you say that?
Oh, I'm thinking of any number of God, of course, now I can't. Nothing comes to mind. Take a sitcom like Little Mosque on the Prairie, and how people were able to tell what is a very common story across not just Canada, but Western society, of integration of Islam into a Western secular democracy and the challenges that come with it. And of course, they use humor in a way that other people might use philosophy or intellectual exposition. But there's something very universal and very approachable with that. And that lens, as opposed to the American, cultural market that has, sitcoms filled with black people and sitcoms filled with white people and, not too much cross-culture, which is unfortunately the reality of the United States all too often. That is not Canada's reality.
You haven't mentioned First Nations and Aboriginal peoples. I know not by design you haven't, but where do you believe the First Nations and Aboriginals experience fits into our cultural identity?
We wouldn't have figured out how to create a country in this place that was too big, too empty, if we hadn't been deeply informed by the people who lived here first. French settlers, English settlers learned to, and it's actually illustrated well in the American historian David Hackett Fisher, I believe, who wrote Champlain's Dream. This idea that here you can go beyond the various identities. John Ralston Saul wrote about it as well in A Fair Country, where the identities are added to each other. And you can have English and French and then layer on all the other languages and identities that have arrived here in successive waves, informed by the fact that if you're going to make it through this winter, if you're going to survive on this land, you're going to have to draw on a level of respect, not just for the land, but for each other, that was intrinsic in many of our First Nations conceptions of identity. Not that they weren't warring with neighboring communities, but that there was a process of adoption and fluidity of identity that I think deeply informs the New World.
You've mentioned the United States a few times. We've both mentioned the United States a few times, and it's hard to talk about Canadian culture without talking about the United States, interestingly, sometimes. There's always been a concern, especially in English-speaking Canada, that there's far too much cultural encroachment from the United States. Do you feel that way?
When you frame it that way, it looks like the solution to that is to build up stronger walls and prevent Hollywood from landing so hard on us. Well, that's an argument that I've had over the past decades with Quebecers over what the best way to protect Quebec culture is. Is it to build up walls and keep the Anglos out, or is it to strengthen and celebrate our own cultural productions in a way that we don't feel threatened by and are happy to compete with? And does that mean, you know, pouring a little more money so we can compete on the same level with Hollywood? Absolutely. I think the same frame goes for Canada. Instead of worrying about keeping things out, can we start making sure that our artists and our creators have a level playing field, which means access to markets going to be a little bit more difficult. It means telling the stories is going to be a little more challenging. But I think as a society, we owe it to ourselves to build up rather than to wall off.
Well, the question then comes back to how different are we from Americans, and what is our cultural identity? And getting back to your book, you write that the Liberals want to return to being a unifying national party. If we can extend that idea again to Canadian culture, you started the interview by saying our identity is a mixture of identities, mm-hmm. the diversity that we have. Is there such a thing, Justin Trudeau, as a singular unified Canadian identity?
Absolutely. Absolutely there is. It's just we keep getting wrapped up in what a Canadian should look like or sound like or you know, how they should walk or how they should talk or how they should pray. And of course, you cannot define that for any Canadian. What we are is a country in the world that actually defines itself through shared public values, values of openness, respect, compassion, a willingness to work hard, a desire to be there for each other, a search for equality, for justice, for opportunity. Now, these are things that countries around the world aspire to as shared values. We define ourselves by those. No matter where you come from around the world, you come to Canada, you get to play by those values, you become a full-fledged Canadian. And that is, it's practically magic, because no other place in the world can do that. Think of a typical French person, Frenchman, or a typical a Danish woman, or a typical citizen of Cameroon or Japan. You know, what, you like it or not, a particular set of, you know, characteristics jumped into your mind on each of those that can't when you say a typical Canadian. But that's the challenge that they're facing in France, in Denmark, in Cameroon, in Japan. How do you define our identity when there are so many
in
others,
a new global world,
so many others around us? And it's those shaping around values that makes us extremely important in this world in which there is such conflict and contrast.
Your father is very much associated with our collective idea of what it is to be Canadian. I mean, even if he had legions of detractors too, there was a real sense, a vision there. His reign also happened in an era when we had, polls tell us, much more faith in political institutions and our leaders. Is it realistic to believe that a prime minister today can nurture Canadian identity as effectively as your father did, or as effectively as it was communicated in an earlier era?
If I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing. And I wouldn't be doing it the way I'm doing it. I've been taking a lot of hits from pundits, from media, from even liberals who are saying, you can't be serious about not going with attack ads, about not responding to the terrible things that people are saying with at least the same amount of strength and vehemence. Mm. And for me, it's not about what do you need to do to win an election, because Mr. Harper demonstrated that you can go with attacks and negativity and division and win an election, even win a majority. But what I also feel he's demonstrated is that once you've won your majority that way, it becomes very, very difficult, if not impossible, to actually govern for the entirety of the country. That once you've pit East against West, English against French, liberal elites versus, rural grassroots, it becomes really difficult to bring them together around a common theme. And that's where the cynicism that defines how Canadians feel about politics these days is so incredibly dominant as a discourse. And I realize, and I talk about it a lot in the book, how my team realized early on that it wasn't just about positioning ourselves in a way to win the next election. How we win the next election is going to be extremely important in how we're able to actually govern the country. So as we choose to set aside the tools that turn people away from our opponents' parties, that turn people away from politics and motivate a small, angry minority, as effective as those are, we're saying now, no, we're going to have to start to reach out on those things that we share as a country, those things that we, that regardless of whether you're in Cornerbrook or Cornwall or Sydney, Vancouver Island, you are hoping for the same things out of your community, out of your family, out of yourself. And that challenge, if we're properly met, will be exactly what we should be celebrating in 2017 when we mark 150 years since we became a country in paper, 100 years since we became a country in reality. Because to my mind, it didn't happen until Vimy Ridge, where we all fought and died together and realized that there was such a thing as a Canadian.
A final question, and it will be about the election of 2015. And I hope that we formally get to do this again here, probably in around election time, and revisit some of these conversations and see how you're doing with the passion you've brought to conversation around culture and arts today. There's a lot of people listening to this show. I mean, there's a lot of people who would listen to any program, but, you know, in this one in particular, those listening in Canada who really profoundly care about culture in this country, care about our identity, and care about arts institutions. And election after election get frustrated by the fact that those things don't seem to be on the agenda. And I wonder if you can tell us whether culture, I mean, given that it is a multi-billion dollar, as you said, from the outset industry, just the way some of the other industries that get a lot of attention seem to get a lot of attention are, I wonder if you can tell us whether for the Liberal Party of Canada and for you in this forthcoming election campaign in 2015, culture and arts will be a priority and will be on the agenda.
Yes. Absolutely. I've gone through 2 years of putting off, revealing what the platform is, because the platform comes out at election time. But I can guarantee you there will be significant commitments and a vision that we're sharing about how culture matters economically, but also around who we are as a nation.
It's good to see you. Thanks for doing this
today.
Great
to see you, Jian.